Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage IPC Chair Bob Nevis.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining us today on this beautiful morning in San Diego. I'm Bob Nevis, Chairman and CTO of Microtech Laboratories China. I'm newly elected IPC Board Chair. I'm very happy to finally be out behind a webcam and be able to directly engage with you guys. It's good to be back in pants again. One of the privileges of being IPC Board Chair is to be able to make the following introduction. It's my pleasure to introduce today's keynote speaker, Dr. John W. Mitchell, IPC President and CEO. For those of you who may not know, John is an electrical and computer engineer, holds an MBA, as well as a doctorate in education. John has a broad background and unique insight into the state of the global electronics manufacturing industry as a business, engineering, and educational perspective. He is truly a big picture thinker. John's keynote will touch on topics that affect all of us in boardrooms, on shop floors, as we deal with factory modernization, supply chain resiliency, workforce demands, and environmental stewardship. We are beginning to better understand, better utilize the technologies and systems required to optimize our journey. We're asking better questions. How can my company be more resilient against the unknowns of the future? What will likely come next? How can I be successful in the industry that changes with the speed of light? Sit back, relax, and let John navigate us down the road of the factory of the future as he presents State of the Industry, Electronics Manufacturing Embraces Digital. Ladies and gentlemen, John Mitchell.
Lightning and the thunder, 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 feel the thunder.
So, welcome to Apex Expo. So, after going virtual last year, it's a thrill to be together again, despite the extraordinary and ongoing challenges related to COVID-19. That we are here now in San Diego is a testament of the tremendous work of IPC staff and dozens of industry volunteers who collectively make this event uniquely valuable. Without the expertise and dedication of many of you, this event would not be possible. It's also a testament to the importance that we place on industry collaboration, professional development, and technological progress. We are a community committed to building electronics better. Better in every possible way, technologically, environmentally, and economically. Now more than ever, we need to draw inspiration and insights from one another, both to navigate the twists and turns of today's global marketplace, and more importantly, to bring our industry into the future. It's this latter subject that I would like to principally address today, our collective drive toward the factory of the future, a future that is unquestionably upon us. But first, let me share a few thoughts about the state of the industry. Across the globe, our industry is growing bigger and faster than in years. All this during a pandemic that has scrambled supply chains and produced historic shortages in parts, components, and semiconductors. Now, these supply chain problems, they're not going away anytime soon. Today, IPC is releasing our most recent research monitoring the pulse of the global electronics industry. And what's the industry telling us? Materials costs and labor costs are a top concern of the industry. 9 in 10 electronics manufacturers report rising material costs now, and over the next, over three-fourths of those reporting also are reporting increased labor costs. It's expected that these costs will continue to increase over the next 6 months. Now, at the same time, there is opportunity. The electronics industry expects orders to remain strong and capacity utilization to expand over the next 6 months, meaning that now is the time to put into place the tools and people you need today and will need to thrive in the years to come. Today, IPC is also releasing our updated economic outlook report. We expect North American industry to grow 3.7%, Europe to grow 4%, Asia to grow 4.8%, and the world economy to improve by 4%. Now, while these are weaker than last year, this is still a solid growth based on a historical basis. The outlook for industry is even brighter as we see its long-term growth driven by two primary trends. First, demand for durable goods, including electronics, is growing globally. Second, the things everyone is buying, regardless of industry, are increasingly reliant on electronics. Consumer demand for electronics grew more than 12% globally in 2021. In North America, consumer spending on durable goods like electronics and vehicles is up 34% from pre-pandemic levels. Likewise, in Europe, manufacturing output for the electronics industry is up 30% over the last year. We continue to hit record highs. But it's the second trend that defines the opportunity for our industry. Some of this trend has been building for decades. In the 70s, only 5% of cars' total cost was the electronic system. Today, that number is 40%. And we believe that figure will crest 50% by the year 2028. IPC member John Deere, long a pioneer in developing and deploying self-driving technology, announced the world's first fully automated tractor just a few weeks ago. The tractors of the 1950s, with almost no electronics components, would never recognize the complexity and agility of today's machines. Now, we know that the pandemic has accelerated a digital transformation in nearly every sector of the economy. Consider, for example, how telehealth has facilitated patient access to providers. The U.S. Department of Health and Human Services reports the share of Medicare visits conducted through telehealth increased 63-fold in 2020 compared to the prior year. Now, today, many patients continue to opt for telehealth services over comparable in-person options. In spite of that 63-fold, McKinsey estimates telehealth use has stabilized at 33 times higher than they were before the pandemic. But the future of healthcare will be more than just Zoom calls with your doctor. Real-time telemedicine will remain important, but increasingly, patients and providers will be moving to asynchronous care. The level of electronics needed for at-home healthcare increases in conjunction with the complexity of care. Now, as the auto sector continues to become even more dependent upon electronics, it will mean more opportunity for our industry, not only within the car, but also building out the infrastructure needed to support a zero-emissions global economy. Our industry's growth over the last 2 years suggests that electronics manufacturers are ready to meet the future demands with grit, ingenuity, and determination. So we should all be proud of what this industry has achieved during some, frankly, pretty challenging times. But this upbeat economic snapshot belays a stark, enduring reality. Succeeding in the electronics industry is never easy. No company can rest on its laurels. The competition is too tough. The pace of innovation too fast. Indeed, one of the most important and perhaps distinguishing characteristics of the electronics industry is its fast pace of change. In the 1960s, technologies invented to bring people into space were mainstreamed into people's homes and vehicles in the early 70s. Medical advances and research that previously took years to decades to develop, now, with DNA sequencing and other techniques, can be tested and launched within months. Information access that would have once been enough to overturn governments is now commonplace in middle school classrooms. Imagine that, sixth graders are empowered with more information and more computing power than any other generation before them. And how do they use it? It's funny, right? But let's be honest, a child's spirit of wonder, creativity, and innovation isn't always channeled wisely. But I'm constantly amazed at the powerfully creative ways in which young people amidst tremendous change are using and shaping technologies to extraordinary ends. Throughout my life, I've tried to protect that spirit of curiosity, creativity, problem solving, and embrace of change that I had as a kid. And it's a spirit that I see in so many across our industry. It's a spirit that is necessary now more than ever, precisely because the industry is changing as fast as it ever has. Our industry needs to adapt and embrace change just as easily as today's sixth grader. The velocity of change, as exciting as it may be, poses a unique challenge to manufacturers that must be embraced with purpose and passion, or risk irrelevancy and ultimately insolvency in today's cutthroat global marketplace. Let's face it, the road today and up ahead has become more and more perilous. The speed at which we must travel has accelerated. The hazards that challenge the journey have become riskier and more frequent. Today, I'd like to talk to you not about the extreme hazards that can derail your company overnight, but the longer term, seemingly imperceptible one that promises to shape our industry far more than any single hazard. Our drive, or lack thereof, toward the factory of the future. This drive toward the factory of the future, I contend, is not unlike a false flat. So what's a false flat? It's a term frequently used in endurance sports like cycling. It refers to a stretch of road that after a climb appears flat, even though it has the most modest of inclines. Now, as an avid triathlete, I have my own slightly different definition: soul-crushing, absolutely soul-crushing. So not seeing the incline can sap you both of physical and emotional energy. And at the very time that you need to be preparing for more difficult parts of the journey ahead, a false flat can delude you into thinking that now's the time to relax and not be focused on your efforts. Likewise, even amidst profound change and global turbulence, and perhaps because of favorable economic conditions, our industry finds itself in a false flat, sneaking up on many of us unaware. Those who approach these times strategically will find themselves at the front of the pack, leaving those who did not frustrated in their wake. So what is this false flat now facing the industry? It's a mistaken belief that the factory of the future is not now, but somewhere up ahead, that investing in it can wait, can be left to others. Once it was sufficient to rely on the strength of other larger organizations to make investments in the future, to chart the paths to new technologies, to develop best practices in manufacturing. And yet, it's becoming more and more clear that those who are sitting back and waiting will likely be left behind, reliant on old technology and outdated skills as the future slips away. So investing in the future is not an easy thing to do. It's just not an easy thing to do for many parts of our industry. With thin margins and a whirlwind of change confronting us, it's natural to take a heads-down approach to the business. But survival is not a long-term strategy. Companies that expect to lead tomorrow need to not only deliver the product orders they must ship tomorrow, they also need to be preparing for the market demands the day after. To employ another sports analogy, companies need to go where the ball will be. Playing where the ball is will not result in a win. Now, knowing where the ball will be is the hard part, of course. But we're understanding better and better each day the drivers that are pushing the industry toward the factory of the future. Appreciating these drivers is critical to make sure that you're in the right place to meet the ball and move down the field to score. So what are these drivers? Technological requirements, operational efficiencies, customer expectations, supply chain resiliency, ESG, and a skilled workforce. So understanding these drivers will empower you to address them in your own organizations with intentionality, earlier rather than later, as the entire industry makes the migration to the factory of the future. A migration that I can't emphasize enough is already well underway. Europe, it is estimated, is 5 to 10 years ahead of North America in the transition to the factory of the future. I'd like to repeat that, given the largely US audience here today. North America is 5 to 10 years behind Europe and Asia in embracing the factory of the future. At the heart of the factory of the future is a digital transformation that Europe and Asia recognize as central to their future economic security. So in the time remaining, I'd like to expand on these six industry drivers, compelling the industry toward modernization and how the industry is responding to them with a suite of technologies, processes, and people that collectively we refer to as the factory of the future. So first, technological requirements. Earlier this year, IPC published an incredibly compelling data-rich report on the state of the global advanced packaging industry with an emphasis on North America. The report was co-authored by IPC's chief technologist Matt Kelly and TechSearch's Jan Vardaman. If you haven't read it yet, I encourage you to download it. It's available for free on IPC's website. It's a report that's receiving considerable attention in the halls of government and among leading tech executives. IPC's work on this issue underscores just how quickly the industry landscape is changing. Once PCB companies had their fixed lane, as did EMS companies, and neither of them had anything to do with advanced packaging. No longer. IPC's work on advanced packaging was inspired by PCB and EMS companies that saw firsthand how technological developments have blurred the lines between their work and the work of IC substrate manufacturers and OSAT companies. The sophistication of today's PCBs is approaching that of IC substrates, and second-level assembly approaching that of chip assembly. Now, I don't mean to suggest that the leap from PCB fabrication to cutting-edge IC substrate manufacturing is an easy or a quick one. It's not. The technology and economics are very different. But the fact that advanced packaging is a strategic consideration for so many PCB and EMS companies reflects how far as an industry we've come. We're stuffing more processing power into even smaller packages by constantly narrowing the width of the traces that connect components. The challenge facing our industry, and quite frankly, each and every one of your companies, is to continue to narrow these traces while maintaining product quality and reliability assurance. That's our industry's promise to customers. Quality and reliability of electronic interconnection amidst rapid and ongoing technological advancements. Keeping pace won't be cheap, however. Yesterday's manufacturing equipment won't meet tomorrow's demands. Staying competitive will require significant investment in your operations. Let me highlight just three. Modernizing manufacturing equipment. Our industry is notorious for its thin margins, thus making it difficult for companies to reinvest in capital equipment. And yet, failure to invest in new equipment puts a company on an inexorable course to irrelevancy. Making investments, then, is not an option. They are an imperative to leverage and respond to the advancements taking place. I'm particularly enthusiastic about the investments some PCB manufacturers are making in additive and semi-additive manufacturing. These new capabilities offer huge leapfrogging opportunities. But even more basic are the investments that companies are making in handling modular design components. Historically, machines have had to handle resistors, capacitors, and basic ICs. Now these components are being integrated into modules with semiconductors, and the modules themselves are the building blocks of most of today's modern devices, like cellular phones. Modernization technologies will likely proliferate to other devices as the capability already exists and designs can be simplified, lowering costs and increasing development and implementation speed. If you can't handle manufacturing with these modules, you're limiting your future opportunities. Second, upgrading facilities. As the sophistication of electronics manufacturing increases, so too does the need to upgrade facilities. Stability and cleanliness is key in the modern facility. That means uninterrupted energy and water, cleaner environments to limit pollutants, and structural changes to support greater automation. Integrating new materials. New manufacturing techniques are frequently driven by new chemicals and materials which, thanks to our industry's close and ongoing collaboration with suppliers, are constantly evolving, always advancing. If you have any questions about the power of materials, consider the spaces and traces achieved in today's IC substrates. The advancements in materials have been central to the narrowing of traces while maintaining reliability. Near term, we need to maintain the pace of progress by developing next generation buildup materials to better facilitate additive and semi-additive manufacturing. The role of additive provokes contentious debate in our industry, but we can all agree that it is a big driver for our industry's future evolution. Longer term, think about what kind of impact graphene may have on the electronics industry. Graphene is a thin layer of carbon, one atom thick, that offers flexibility, strength, and connectivity. How might it change our use of copper, which remains the principal conductor used in PCBs? All right, so second, operational efficiency. As an electrical engineer, I am passionate about technological advancements. But as a businessman, I know that technological innovations must be married with business innovations. This is where the factory of the future truly shines. New equipment and new materials will help you build a better proverbial mousetrap. But the processes you put in place will allow you to achieve greater productivity, improving environmental impact, speed, accuracy of production, and overall cost savings. Instituting new processes can be overwhelming, given that we don't always understand just how efficient we are. I love the story of the London Hospital, it's a children's hospital. It was struggling with the complexity and frankly with fatalities in their ICU. That hospital reached out to Ferrari's Formula One pit stop crew, brought them in, had them analyze and improve their interactions between workers and workflow in the hospital's ICU. Fatalities dropped, efficiency went up. It's a reminder that often we need an outside perspective, perhaps even outside our industry, to see what is right in front of us. Adopting a learning attitude allows organizations to find new and better ways of doing things across their processes. Combining big data and data analytics with new process theories may allow a traditional factory to find ways of doing things that will not only save money and time, but could allow for new product capabilities. In our own industry, we are adopting our own pit crew approaches. Sometimes this means better collaboration between peers, but more and more often, it means communication between machines. IPC's Connected Factory Exchange Standard, a standard developed by the industry and now adopted by almost all of the major equipment manufacturers, is leading the way in communication for a factory of the future. CFX allows plug-and-play IoT communication across the manufacturing environment, where all equipment, manufacturing processes, and transactional stations can communicate without the need for specialized software. CFX is already bringing down costs and increasing productivity in electronics manufacturing facilities by reducing manual processing and a reliance on expensive and time-consuming middleware solutions. But imagine how powerful this functionality will be as we begin to marry it with artificial intelligence and big data. We'll be able to move more quickly to identify and remedy, in some cases without human involvement, design errors or manufacturing flaws. Imagine a machine in the middle of the line gives a stop order to the machine at the front of the line and the requisite corrections to be made. This will allow for higher yields and even faster new production introduction cycles. Third, customer expectations. So these new processes are also creating greater customer expectations, especially around digital transparency. The very electronics that we manufacture have created opportunities for customers to see the factory floor from thousands of miles away. What was once considered a nicety will increasingly become an expectation. More and more manufacturers are providing their customers with dashboards that provide real-time data on the orders being fulfilled. Digital transparency provides a competitive advantage for your customers. It allows them to more easily and quickly consider product design modifications, quality and reliability, regulatory compliance obligations, and opportunities to build electronics better. Offering this level of transparency comes with risks, including to security. But it also offers new opportunities for greater collaboration and trust between customer and supplier across the supply chain. All right, so let's talk about supply chain. Supply chain woes are no secret to those of us in the electronics industry. An electronics manufacturer not accustomed to navigating, or at least weathering, supply chain disruptions just doesn't stay in business very long. Supply chain disruptions are a fact of our industry. A US reporter suggested to me recently that increased production of semiconductor chips was likely to lead to a glut of chips, remedying the tech industry's supply chain concerns. Hooray! It's all over. Well, putting aside that dubious nature of that assertion, here's what we know. The supply chain issues will persist because they're broader than the chip industry and they predate COVID. 5 years ago, one of the chief concerns expressed by electronics manufacturers was, surprise, surprise, a shortage of parts and components. Companies were forced to scour the globe for chips, but also capacitors and resistors, as well as base materials. So supply chain disruptions are not new. And yet, the ongoing pandemic has been unique in systematically affecting basically all industries globally. As the pandemic raced across the globe in the early months of 2020, many businesses quickly discovered their supply chains were strained and they were unable to deliver on orders received. Years of optimizing around just-in-time systems had left organizations woefully exposed. The flexibility businesses had built into their organizations left them fragile and vulnerable to dislocations in the marketplace. The very cost-cutting and efficiency measures businesses had implemented to help them compete worked to their detriment due to COVID. It's another reminder that supply chain resiliency doesn't come without trade-offs. Historically, resiliency came and still comes at a cost of fully optimized supply chains. And that increases costs, complexity, and risk. Well-optimized supply chains are ideal when they're operating as they should, but can be catastrophic when disruptions occur. So, if that's the case, why do so many companies in our industry seek to fully optimize their supply chains? Because the alternative has proven to be an even greater and arguably more certain risk. That without well-optimized supply chains, a business is likely to go bust well before the next disaster strikes. I believe, however, that the pandemic revealed the degree to which the pendulum had swung too far in the direction of optimization at the expense of resiliency. So it highlighted the risk that being unprepared for the next, that we are unprepared for the next global catastrophe. As a result, companies are thinking anew about how to make their supply chain resiliency a pillar of their corporate strategy and a guiding principle in their operations. Every factory of the future will incorporate some level of resiliency. An increased focus on resiliency will drive many, many changes in how companies manage their complex global supply chains. Why? Because the factory of the future empowers manufacturers to mitigate the burden and risks. Digitization, artificial intelligence, automation, real-time monitoring, and the concept of digital twin offer manufacturers radical and powerful new tools to manage manufacturing operations taking place in their facilities and in the facilities of their suppliers around the world. Production issues in one plant can quickly be identified and trigger an increased production in plants elsewhere. The industry's development and support of global applicable standards are also helping companies to improve the resiliency of their supply chains more efficiently, in part by decreasing the time and expense required to qualify new facilities and ensure ongoing quality. Now, quality audits, they're not going away. But the greater visibility companies have into their suppliers, the easier and faster those qualifications will be. And that makes all the difference when cataclysmic disruptions occur. ESG. So I intentionally did not spell out this acronym on my slide because I'd like to know how many people in this room are familiar with this. By show of hands, if you know what this term means, raise your hand. Wow, not many. That's good. I thought there'd be more. I'm glad some of you do. That's great. I can assure you that it is a term that in the years ahead, we will all know. It stands for environment, social, and governance. And it's a construct developed principally by the investment community to evaluate how non-financial factors might affect a company's current or future performance. As an example, a national trucking company that makes no effort to leverage hybrid, natural gas, or electric engine technology is likely to receive a lower environmental rating than a company that does. Now, this lower rating isn't a moral judgment. Instead, it's meant to guide investors, especially large institutional investors, as they decide which companies are most likely to succeed now and in the future, and thus be worthy of investment. These ESG ratings have already had a big influence on investment decisions, but also on government. More and more governments globally are using this construct to compel greater data collection and reporting on the ESG-related practices of public and private companies. Many of you may recall, for example, the costs and burden that US and European reporting requirements on conflict minerals imposed on the industry. These expectations are not going away. They're only going to increase as investors, regulators, and customers drive companies to meet increased expectations on ESG performance. Disclosure requirements on climate change, diversity and inclusion, economic inequality, and critical materials management, just to name a few. Every company will be affected, public or private, directly or indirectly. This offers new opportunities to redefine business performance and to position the industry to lead with new, sustainable technologies, sustainable product design, and circular business models. A factory of the future comprises business models that account for ESG. Now, as an industry, we can work together to utilize standards and practices that facilitate data collection. We can improve on existing standards for materials declaration and information exchange, and we can create new standards that achieve and exceed expectations set by investors, civil society, and governments. But just as we bolster industry standards and practices, we need to leverage the powerful tools that the Factory of the Future offers. Now, we've already established the Factory of the Future enables efficiencies in processes. It optimizes the interconnectedness of software and hardware, as well as the interconnectedness of supply chain members. That makes the Factory of the Future key in helping to meet ESG expectations. A Factory of the Future prioritizes system integration. And system integration will require enhanced communication of data through robust and improved data architecture. ESG expectations will change the operating conditions for companies. And those changes are compatible with and supportive of those necessary for a functional Factory of the Future. To build electronics better, manufacturers must do so with awareness and responsibility to ESG factors, fully integrating them into their business core, weaving together existing and bold new industry activities to support industry engagement on a range of concerns. So last year, IPC launched the ESG for Electronics Steering Group, and we will continue to engage with this steering group to stay ahead of ESG obligations and enabling our industry to maintain their roles as knowledgeable leaders. Number six, and I have to confess, this one's my favorite, the workforce challenge. So all of the exciting changes we've discussed for the Factory of the Future are all contingent upon one thing, a skilled workforce, a pipeline that needs constant attention and nurturing. The workforce challenge can be thought of as two general challenges, each with two areas to focus. The two general challenges are talent acquisition, bringing in new people, and talent retention, keeping the people you have. We're seeing challenges on both broad fronts very clearly today. And these challenges are not limited to the electronics industry either. We have headlines talking about each of these issues, and as I speak with executives around the world, they're echoing these headlines. We can't find people. We're losing people, or both. It's been dubbed the Great Resignation on the second issue. With respect to acquisition, there are two actions that need to be happening. And I'm pleased to point out that IPC is working on both of these actions with the industry's help. We need a pipeline of incoming talent, and we need efficient onboarding of that talent once they walk through the doors, so they can start working effectively right away. With respect to a pipeline, unlike many other industries, the electronics manufacturing industry does not have a pipeline of talent set up to come into the workforce. Now, these systems typically take the form of certifications available in high schools and community colleges, so individuals can, if they choose, move directly into their first job in electronics manufacturing industry. IPC is working with industry and governments to correct this on a broad scale. Additionally, the challenge of onboarding new talent, often without a background in electronics, is an area that many of you have shared with me as a challenge you are facing. How do we bring in and effectively train people quickly? How can I take someone off the street and make them productive in a few hours? It's gratifying to hear from the industry that programs like IPC's Electronics Assembly for Operators have helped thousands do exactly that, go from zero to contributing employee in less than a week. On the retention side, the two challenges to be overcome are equally important. They're having pathways for career progression and upskilling or new skill development in an ever-evolving work environment. Having a clear vision of how one will be challenged and can progress in their career at a company is shown to be, in study after study, is shown to be more important than the salary they make. People want to get better. People want to be challenged. And having pathways is an important way for your team to understand and see the opportunities ahead. One of the clear messages of a factory of the future that I hope you've been hearing, not only here from me, but as you understand the larger landscape of where the industry is heading, is that change is going to be a common occurrence for us going forward. With changing devices, processes, technologies, equipment, and more, new skills are going to be required. They're going to be required constantly. So the second part of ensuring retention is upskilling, or providing new skills to your people on an ongoing basis. On all of these fronts, IPC is working with industry to understand the most important skills and pathways and develop programs for the industry, like many other industries already have. These will provide solutions to the concerns in an area that, frankly, was never really intended to be a core competency for electronics manufacturers. Now, we don't even know what jobs we'll be hiring for 3 years from now, but we're often looking to schools to develop these workers for us today. And what typically happens is that a student will finish school and then the real education begins, with not enough productivity happening fast enough. Wouldn't it be great if the rookies on your bench could get playing time as soon as you drafted them? We're working to make that a reality. Okay, so now what? Having a factory of the future, it's not a goal to be achieved. Now that sounds contradictory, but it's something akin to saying when you wake up in the morning, hey, today's tomorrow. There's always more to do on the horizon. It's a mental state that will continue to evolve and develop. It's not just the latest machine, the latest process, the best trained people, the right capabilities, or the right partners. It's all of these and more. We must become future-focused every day. Now more than ever, the industry needs each of you to shape the future, because I can guarantee you that if you're not shaping your future, your competitors will be. Or worse yet, people in government offices with very little understanding of our industry will be shaping our future for us, as they have in the past, and frankly, as they're striving to today. And perhaps that's the greatest risk to this industry, that those who know nothing about our industry will constrain or direct its evolution. For some, the first future to focus on will be the future of next week. But it can't stop there. We must move our sights beyond that which is right in front of us on the road to the future. We must look down the path as far as we can see, and we must start today to be ready to use the bridges we have built or climb into that flying car to traverse the canyons that impede our reaching our ever-moving destination, the factory of the future. Because the factory of the future is now. Thank you. Are there any questions? Do we even have mics out there? We do have mics out there. Any questions, comments, debates, tomatoes? None at all. Really? I can't see very well. Is there something? There's one. Very good. Thank you all for coming, by the way, to APEX. Never mind the keynote.
John, I just wanted to thank you for mentioning the 175X family. We've been running this for 20 years, and it's a digital representation of your product, and most have never heard of it. So understanding that and expressing it, we support what you're saying wholeheartedly, and that's what we've been working for 2 decades.
Awesome.
So thank you.
Thank you. We'll have to make T-shirts. 175X. Anything else? I can't see you guys. Oh, there was one in the back.
This isn't a technical question about anything that you presented, but will this presentation be available on an online video that
Yes.
There's parts of it I would like to play for some of our management teams.
You want to get me in trouble. I got you. All right. Okay, great. Yes, I believe we will be putting this up available online in some format soon. Don't look for it tomorrow, but yeah, soon. Thank you. There's one over here.
Good morning. I've seen IPC's outreach with student chapters grow in recent years. Has there been any thought regarding providing curriculum guidance to universities towards a certificate or other endorsement students could earn on their way towards graduation?
So yes, we are trying to do exactly that. So we're trying to provide, when we work with, especially when we're talking with high school, so what she's referring to is we have the IPC Education Foundation. It's a 501c3 that is a subsidiary of ours that is working with high schools, community colleges, universities, et cetera. There are chapters out there that we're engaging students, trying to make them aware of our industry, et cetera. But one of the strong requests we continue to get from teachers is, how do I get my student some sort of credential so that they can say, oh yes, I have this skill. And so the very same programs that we are working on for the industry, we are working to do corollary programs for the education space. So yes, that is our intent, and we're just grateful to those of you in the audience and in the industry who've been helping us build these programs so they're relevant. We really, just like our standards processes, we don't create the education programs. We go out to the industry, and the industry tells us what they need, and then we just make them, we use the instructional design expertise to make them consumable, if you will, but it's the technology that we, and what you need that we learn from the industry. But yes, another question here.
John, thank you very much for a great presentation. The USPAE, do you feel that's making the progress you had hoped for, or do you, I mean, is it stagnation, or what is your assessment, please?
Yeah, so USPAE, for those of you who are not aware, is the US Partnership for Assured Electronics. It is focused for US-based companies to work, based companies in the industry, to work directly with government to obtain funding so that we can solve industry challenges and the like. It's been a little slower going than we would have liked. Things got bogged down in some approvals, but now they are the manager of the Defense Electronics Consortium, USPAE is, which should be, it's a funding mechanism for the government to be able to provide funds to the industry. The first project that has come through that has been the defense lead-free piece that we're working on there. It's a $40 million program that we've gotten $15 million funded, and there's another $7.5 that's on the table for this year. It's about a five-year program. But we're anticipating, we finally cleared those hurdles in December, and so we anticipate even more and more programs coming through that going forward, which should help the U.S. industry be able to have more access to those funds that typically maybe not everybody had access to. So it took longer than I would have liked. Everything in government seems to take longer than I would like. But yes, it's moving forward very well. Thank you. Any other questions? Oh, yeah, there's one. Hold on.
Hey, John.
Hey.
So could you shed some light on what the demand is for technicians in the industry, and I know that IPC is doing several surveys to try to capture that data, if you could shed some light on that.
Yeah, that's a great question. So it's interesting, as I think about the workforce challenges that we talk about, in our industry, we kind of put them into maybe four buckets. You have operators, you have technicians, you have engineers, and then you have management. And you know, management, we don't do anything. So it's all about the operators, technicians, and engineers. I'm kidding, you know, but anyway. So we believe there is a large demand for technicians that is only going to increase, especially in as we see increased automation. As lines become more and more automated, you're going to need technicians who are capable to manage those machines. So we're trying to work with industry to create technician certification and qualifications. So you will know if you go to hire a certain type of technician, if they have this kind of certification, then you'll know that job and what their capabilities are. But we believe that is a growing need, and it's only going to continue to grow. Anybody else? All right. Thank you all for your time.
Not a yes, sir. Not a follower. Fit the box, fit the mold. Have a seat in the foyer. Take a number. I was lightning.